it's impossible. In the, at the same time, we want to create an ecosystem where innovation and business can be made at the same time. This has certain complications because, of course, business wants stability and innovation is the contrary of stability. So we need to find a good balance between them. And then we have certain goals that drive us. This is the most easy say of what are the goals. First, that you, not just us, can make money out of our. In fact, we do not need to make money out of our. This for me not important. But okay. Also, we have to invent new solutions to existing problems. We wanted to do a powerful and innovative language. Why? Because yes, Smalltalk is very cool, but we believe that it's not the end, the sum plus ultra of the programming languages for environment, as you want to speak. There is a lot of things to create, there is a lot of new things to add, even if, as we believe, this is the best approximation that we have until now. So in this way, Pharo is a jump, but also it's a very mature environment. Why? Because, of course, it stands in giant shoulders, as everybody knows, because it's not just the history of small 80, it's also a fork from another diary, which is Squid, which was made by Daniel in 1995. So we have a lot of history, and we have a lot of material. And it's also the work of hundreds of contributors. In all our history, we have found a lot of people that has contributed. Some of them remains in the community, some of them are doing other stuff, some of them are doing other small talks too. But we are happy to have the contribution of all of them. So, as I was saying, we are young, but we are not so young. We are already 10 years. Pharo started in 2007. So, 2017, if I do the correct map, we have 10 years. And in 10 years, we have made a lot of changes. In fact, I made that slide, and then I was not really happy because it looks very similar, which is cool because people recognize Pharo immediately, but most of the changes are not actually visible. Instead of this one last version that we switched to that thing, precisely to say, okay, it's a new version. So you can actually see that it's a new version. And probably Pharo 7 will be a wide thing again, and we are going to start from Google Center. In fact, you can switch your thinking about this. It's not really important. But we wanted to actually express that. But wait, thing is, yes, changes are not visible, but why? Because for what we want to do is everything is about infrastructure. What we are going to do all the time is to create a good infrastructure to do the next step. And we do not believe in small changes. For us, the real revolutionary changes is the accumulation of small changes. There is no small contribution. Fixing a typo in a comment is important because then someone else will read it and will read it accurately and will be able to actually do something with that. So, at the end, the incremental changes that we do, they create a huge change. I have several examples, but I don't have so much time. But we have two changes that are huge, like for example the OPA compiler, which is the introduction of a tool that allows us to have an incredible amount of other things like first class instance variable, slots as in list, and we can have meta links, which allows us to have something really nice, like final real breakpoints instead of having to write self out all the time. So we can actually add a breakpoint there. And there are small things that look like they are not so important, but we didn't have it. So now we have it, and it's good. And then, real problem of doing this is that it looks like fixing your car while you are still driving, which means that you can crash very, very lightly. But it's a great job, and we really love it. So last year we released Pharo 6, and now it's Pharo 6.1, which is the current stable version. It was 12 months of work in which we closed 1,400 more than 1,400 issues. And those issues were fixed, discussed, worked by more than 80 contributors all around the world, which I think is our biggest achievement. We did some changes, as I say, it's about infrastructure, so most of the changes are not visible by you. But we have some important changes. The first that we introduce is a preview of what will be our SCM tool, or versioning tool, which is Iceberg, which relies in Git because we believe that Monticello is it has a certain issue. No. It does not adapt very well to our current needs. It does not scale to our levels of work in task problems. And it was great and we loved it, but now we have to move on and get on. And well, Iceberg, it was a preview for 6.1, it was working more or less okay, but it has still some problems which are being developed now in us. We incorporated a new change log system, which is Epicea. There, it was his doctoral work in India, and basically the idea is that you can track also refactors and different things. Again, we are still having coexisting Epicea and the old transaction log that we have, because the transaction log is a lot more than that. Of cats where everything was there, so we need to clean a lot until we can actually drop it. But we are working. And thanks to the work of Elliot Miranda, all the BM dev, this crew, myself, and we have now 64 bits. Yes. We have 64 bits in Mac and in Linux, and not in Windows. Not because it's not possible to do it, it's because we rely on a lot of external libraries, and to use those libraries, we need actually to validate that they compile and everything's okay in Windows, and I didn't have the time to do it yet. But Pharo 7 will become Windows for Windows. And well, also we are working a lot in the new GT tools, which are the inspectors and the debugger, that with this idea of multi-view, which in my opinion is just another way of saying it's but okay, it's that. And as you have seen, the new inspectors, they show a lot more than the traditional ones, and they can be modified by you very easily. But that all of that is the past. Now we are working in Pharo 7. So what will are going to do now. One thing that is not in the next slides that we will talk is that we are doing a complete revamp of our development process. It's not in the title, it's not very descriptive. It's complicated because we are changing everything. Because all sources now are in Git and in a format that we just made, and the development process now incorporates a pull request, it works a legit. Everything is in GitHub, and we use pipelines of Jenkins for building the images, and we build a lot of images, and we test a lot of things, and sometimes not everything works. In fact, right now we are in the process of building it. So the biggest change of Pharo 7 will be the new process. When we finish, we want to have a perfectly old process that you can use as you are used to in other environments. Like you join, you do change, you commit, you do a pull request, and okay, you forget. That's it. So that should be like that, and that is also to validate that this is a valid way of work also in Pharo. Because people always complain that it's hard to do teamwork in Pharo because of Monticello, because of that, and then if we are adopting the social coding tools and you can work with them in an easy way, then there is no complaints. You can do it. So, then, but that's not all. We are also doing another huge step that we have been working since last 5 years, which is a bootstrap for real. Why it says for real? Because we usually call it bootstrap to a lot of things, like converting an image from an older version to a new version, which is in fact a system trace. It's not it's an object tracing. It's not a bootstrap. You're converting, or you can call bootstrap a web technology, or you can call the bootstrap a lot of things that there are things. Bootstrap for us is being able to construct an image from scratch, from zero, just for source code, With this, we are going to fix one of these problems of being driving while changing, because if we have huge changes, we can rely that bootstrapping it will not crash everything else. That's the thing. But also, it makes the process a lot more repeatable, and then it allows multiple different images. So in the future, we envision Pharo as, okay, Pharo is the distribution with all the things, all the tools, all the frameworks that we provide, but everybody can make their own image with the tools that they want. So you can do a complete headless image for doing server work, you can do a complete morphic image or a complete block image, which is stuff. And then with this for doing it. Also it's good to have it because or Pharo, there were objects that were alive since 1995. I think they deserve a better. So we can start new ones. And of course, another change is the full adoption of Iceberg. I already talked a little bit, but Iceberg basically put us in a visible world. One of the reasons why we are adopting this is also because we want to gain visibility. Now, we have a lot of projects, a lot of things that are made in Pharo that are not visible because they are stored in our own storage that are not correctly indexed. Then nobody can see them. So, for example, now I just doing a quick check, and we have already more than 18,000 projects that are using Python. Of course, not all of those are is a portable format, but all of us are smalltalk. And all of them are in GitHub and easy to search. And of course, we added Bitbucket and GitLab because they are cool. In fact, I think it's not super cool, but since it's not very visible, it fits our purpose, so we are doing it. But, okay. And other full change that we are going to do is we believe that Nautilus needs to be with Ahead. Nautilus is our current browser. And in fact, some of us believe that it should never be there. Because it was a source of problems during years. I spent far too much time fixing. But at the end, it was also a good browser in the sense that it was fulfilling everything we need, but in a clumsy way. So we have a new browser which is being developed by this professor. Which is called Calypso, because Calypso was the and then it keeps the maritime names. But the important part of Calypso is that it was developed for remote browsing. One thing that we have now is the Pharo, which is something that allows you to connect and develop in a remote image with a full environment, so you could have, for example, a bootstrap image which is complete headless, but you could connect to it and work on it anyway. And then we decided to take that browser that is well designed and a lot of enhancement that we wanted and use it also for the full ID. It's very extensive. And it has already a lot of plugins that we add. It's still not fully debugged, but it will be for Pharo 7 release when we release. It's already, you can already use it. We are also doing something that everybody complained at the beginning, which is the factor of full stream package. Why? Because it was a mess. Because it was everything mixed all together, so it was absolutely incomprehensible. And then we wanted to have a clean interface where you have to operate a stream, and if you want to use a, you add an operator. No, in fact, no, because I started talking to you. So then. But okay. But well, I don't have. So we are going to do it, but again, this is backward compatible, so there will not be problem with people. We are changing the refactoring engine because we have made a lot of improvements that are not in the image now, so we are putting the work of this resident by Gustavo. It was cool and it's working. It's also very cool. And so another thing is that we want to compete with Ruby and Bitbucket. So for doing that, we have to have a good scripting engine. It has to be good for scripting. So our competition is not small. We are here. Everybody is here at the game for making smalltalk better. So, but the competition are other languages, like in this case, Ruby. So, we are working for this. We have already real headless images because I don't know if you know, but right now, Pharo is for any open smalltalk VM based. Smalltalk, and they are not real headless. They simulate it by not opening the window. But the window is there. So that consumes cycles and that consumes other things. And also, we are going to continue cleaning. As I they say, I mean, I'm going to retire in Nautilus, we are going to retire a lot of things that we do not use more anymore. And they are there for backward compatibility or because removing them is not so easy. For example, committed is not used in Salvador. Nobody uses it because it doesn't work. I know it because it does not work. But we use part of the meta model, which does work for doing other stuff. So for removing that, we need to actually refactor all that. The old compiler needs to be removed and needs to be loaded. And also the old inspector needs to be removed, but we need a basic inspector for the cases when you need to actually inspect the inspector, for example. Or if you want to do an image without all the ID, you want to do a basic image, and a basic inspector is very useful. So that's what we are doing for Pharo 7. Now, it's a lot of promises, but most of those is already working, so you can try it. I don't know if Pharo 7 now is like in the leading edge. So, do not expect that everything works as it should. But it's working very well. In fact, I'm using it for everything. But for the future, we are going to still change everything. We want to replace Morphic, but Morphic is a huge beast with a lot of history. But it actually does a lot of things, so it's not so easy to replace it. And we are going to work a lot in the VM side. Timon is working in Cisco Fibre compilation. We are going to be one of the 4 or 5 languages in the world that have this, which means that we are going to gain another 30 or 35% of performance. I'm not going to go over the details, but there is a lot of costs on the amount of explains. Basically, the idea is that it makes methods larger behind, so you do not create frames, you do not create a lot of things, and then you will create some space. And then, well, the VM is also having a lot of movement. One of the problems that we have now is that we want a really good FFI package, and we'll talk about that Friday. But FFI itself is synchronous, so you have a blocking call each time you do it, and certain tasks need to be asynchronous. So we are working with Thread FFI. We want an event driven VM because like that we can have embedded VMs. Can use Pharo in another language or another system. Under the VM is common. But that's what we, as a Pharo team, or I don't know how to call it, Pharo community, are working for Pharo. But Pharo community is a lot more than that. In the last years, we have a lot of libraries, or whatever you want to call it, that has been developed outside us, which are, most of them are in GitHub now, and are part of those 80,000 that they say. And there is some really moving community that is creating all the time new things. And we have worked also, not me because I'm just about that, but in a lot of documentation, which is not bad, because there are a lot of books, I'm just pointing the transport that are there, but there are a lot of books that are in the world, booklets that teach how to do small talk, to Pharo in this case, but okay, that's still small talk. And then we have, since last year, a MOOC, which is massive online, books, but okay, it's just to learn it. Last year there were more than 2,000 people that participated and finished it, and this year just started, and there are already more than 2,000 people learning smalltalk without it. So I think it's not bad. It's made by Esteban Lorenzano, Fares and Daniel Casu, which are professors, a lot of people much more prepared than me for the courses. Okay. And of course, since they are French and they really wanted to, they say that it's better to speak well in French than bad in English, so rather coming in French and with subtitles, that they have subtitles. There are subtitles in several languages now, and Spanish, in fact, is almost finished, so it will be with Spanish subtitles, and there is also English, it's double in English now, so if you don't want to hear the French because it sounds weird, you will have like those one of the History Channel that is French behind them, somewhere speaking English. Yes. And then, last year also, we have incorporated a lot of more of users. We have several companies working. For example, recently we knew a company in China has a full market of big machines to rent. Tracks and that. For working, it's full done in Pharo, which is Solarito. They are now part of the consortium. But okay. Anyway, basically, we have a very different community, which I think is very good for everybody here, because we are working a lot in spreading. I think all of this makes Pharo also a really good platform, not just for learning objects, but also to evangelize about small talk. I think it's Pharo, we are working on Pharo in a tool that anyone that sees and works on that wants to keep using it, and that means that wants to stay using this model. So, I'm going to take 5 minutes. I'm sorry. But okay. The real thing is how we maintain that, how we want to maintain that. And this is a really important question because we want to have a sustainable plan, something that keeps stays alive in time, not just 10 years, but the next 20 more. And we want to have it. And for that, we created the thing that we call the Pharo Consortium, which is the assembly of enterprises and individuals that want to contribute to Pharo and to the sustainability of Pharo. In fact, we already have been very successful. This is not very visible, but because they are a lot. Not true, but we have several enterprises that use Pharo, or not just Pharo. There are some that use Smalltalk, for example, JP Morgan, which is the one in the middle that nobody can see. JP Morgan, they do not use Pharo, they use Smalltalk, but they are interested in keeping Pharo alive because we are about introduction of new programs. That's the thing. But most of them participate, there are several plans that Latino boards in the Bronx and that. For example, the guys of James also participate here. Of course, obviously they do not do part of Jamestown, but since we have a good merge with tools and that, they are interesting. And, well, also there are academical partners that they participate just by teaching Pharo, using Pharo in their courses. All of those people, except the academical partners, they put some money there, which has worked basically to pay my salary, which is good in my point of view. But we started from 2013 to do this, and we have grown in the income that we have, which means that from starting from next year, from the 1st of January 2018, we will be able to pay a second engineer, which is Clemente Montera, which is the guy that is working in Sista and a lot of European. So we will have two engineers working full time in Pharo to keep the project going. And of course we are ambitious, we want more. So we need people interested, enterprises interested in Pharo to continue so this is because some people has asked. This is has no impact of Pharo. Pharo is will still be need. It's just a better Pharo because some of the companies pay different stuff that we incorporate as libraries, as external libraries of internal stuff. For example, we are going to work in some integration with Corba now that will be available for everybody. And that so basically that's what I have to do. Sorry. And just I have a final message, which is what we are to say. We do Pharo because we love it. It's an open project. I was already in love before, we paid for it. So and Pharo is an excellent tool for inventing your future. So you can get an impact if you join, if you come to work with us in any way. Because this is a platform that we all need. So that's all. Thank you very much. Questions?
We work with the CSI
what we have a general strategy and then a forceful strategy. The general strategy is that we have cycles that last like 8 months, and then we use the last 4 months as stabilization, which this time is going to start in January. And during we actively suggest to all the library providers or people that they update their packages to the newest version in that time. So when the release arrives, everything is there. That does not happen all the time, because since most of the work is open source, is free line work, that there are needs, they need to pay the needs, or at the end they can take more time than everybody would. We have a problem now with the way we solve the dependencies, but anyway, managing the dependencies and versions, that is a hard task in any environment you want. And we have now a problem because I made a catalog, which is where the style installed C-Site, as a temporary solution like 3 years ago. It was meant for 6 months, and it's there since 3 years. Why? Because the real solution that we want, which is a better centralizing place with a better management of dependencies, which is, I don't know, we have some experimental stuff that is called Cargo, but then also they is working in a spec version of the spec, some of the solution. Outside the image version of dependencies that is better than that. And those tools are still not yet there. So it's complicated to release a new version. And especially for frameworks like this, which is huge, complex, and has to work in several platforms. So what finally happens in projects is that I take them and I push the version that works. Say, okay, that's perfect. I say, okay, for Pharo, this is this, and that will work. So, but then I'm kind of busy, so not all the time. So, yes, it's not the ideal situation, but what you can do always is to ask. As I say, your community is very helpful, very new, friendly, and available. So if you send a mail to the list, or you go to Discord, someone will try to help you and can get you working. So that's it.
Hi, you said that you wanted to add an iceberg integration stable for managed dependencies.
Sorry.
You said that you wanted to add an iceberg to manage dependencies, packages, and build like a stable version. And then promise to give free libraries in system like Arch Linux and different Ubuntu, I think that had the same problem. And it's like a distributed problem, because I said it's not my problem, and Pharo said it's not my problem, GitHub said it's not my problem, and it's like these new versions of GitHub free library with OpenSSL, I think that's actually a Russian nice problem.
Yeah, in general, the point of view of Pharo community is that everything in place is my fault. So Iceberg or GitHub or GitHub. Yes, it's complicated. What we do is to distribute our own version of GitHub, for example. It's that one. If you use another one, you will not succeed and we will not support it. So, for example, there was this guy from Arch Linux that say, okay, Iceberg is not going in Arch Linux, okay, if you install the correct library, no, I use the one of actually ask the guys of Apache Linux. Because we provide something with the library that you have to use. If you do not use that, I cannot do anything. And yes, that is what we do. Like, and that's why we are distributing some external libraries, even in Linux, which is not the best approach, but it's the only way that we can ensure that they are going to use that. Especially in the case of BitGit, the problem is that they do not have a lot of care about backward compatibility. So if you use Linux 0.23 with the current version of Iceberg, you will crash. Why? Because they modify one structure, and then decide that the fields were better in the middle. Not at the end, as if you want to have compatibility, you put that, and then okay, then you just store a little bit more of space, and it works in both platforms. No, they added